Hello and welcome to Innovation Oxford. I'm your host, Mike Harding, and we're standing in the middle of the Middle Thames River, just to the east of Kintore, and we're going to be doing some fish sampling with John and Dave, who are using a very unique apparatus. You know, I think of it as shock fishing, but they don't. Come on, we'll meet them. What are these devices going to do?
This puts out a pulsed current, 200 volt current through the water. It forces the fish to come out of cover, and we're able to net them, capture them, see what we've got, and then release them.
The purpose of doing this is what?
Just to know what we've got in our streams. This is probably the most effective and least damaging way to go out and find what fish species we've got where. Actually a mad tom, but one of the type of catfish, has wonderful spines here and here, and supposedly they've got a poison gland associated with them, so they have to be handled with care.
And that's pretty much full grown?
Yeah, they'll get a couple inches longer than this, but they don't get very big, so anglers rarely catch them.
Now, is this a spot where fish would like to hang out?
Yeah. Yeah, anywhere you've got overhead cover, to keep them safe from predators, the herons, kingfishers, things like that. That's the kind of place they hang out right there.
Yep. Like a kingfisher or heron would treat this like sushi.
Yep.
Oh, look at that.
So green side darters.
Darters?
Three of them, and there's a little rock bass.
Is this the bass?
Yeah. These are the darters.
Green darters? Side. Yeah. Whoa. Don't lose them all. Okay. How often do you do this? You check the streams every summer?
We travel, there's a few that we do annually, but most of them will be once every 5 years, once every 10 years. This is the first time we've been into this particular spot.
And so you can go back in time and look at the quality of the fish, the amount, the quality of the fish.
The number of species we get is usually indicative, and some of the species tell us. For example, if we were to find trout in here, we'd know we had pretty much ideal water quality and water temperature, but this is a warm water stream, so we're highly unlikely to find trout. But if we've come in here and find 15 species or 20 species of fish to support that kind of we got some moving here.
Oh, big one!
To support that kind of diversity,
a shiner and a green side.
It has to be a fairly healthy system.
Amazing.
There's one even bigger one there. Wow. That's a good size white sucker there.
Now that's a predator here, right?
No, they're bottom feeders. They clean up all the detritus on the stream bottom.
Oh, he took off.
This guy is a hog sucker. And usually people think of suckers as being, well, they're bottom feeders, as being kind of low life. But this guy, this guy is gone.
Now, the twisting and turning of this river, is that important for fish habitat?
Oh, that's hugely important. That means we've got a natural channel here, one that hasn't been engineered. And the meanders and the series of riffles and pools are of huge importance to fish, the invertebrates that live here. Just the whole way a river functions is critical. So once you see meanders and riffles being our shallow turbulent areas, pools being the flat areas with slow flowing current, yeah, those are very, very important.
What are the abundance of the fish tell you about the quality of water in this stream?
A lot of our streams have very abundant fish populations, whether the water quality is good or bad. If it's really bad, the abundance goes down.
Mm.
But moderately nutrient enriched, we still have an awful lot of fish. The fact that we've got a really impressive variety of fish here means we've got pretty good water quality. You know, if it was totally dominated by carp and a few of the other minnow species, then we'd know we had poor water quality. But with this kind of variety, we've got pretty good conditions here, both habitat and water quality.
So the fishing has been pretty good here, and it sounds like we're in really good shape environmentally here in the river. We'll be right back with more from Upper Thames in just a moment. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Innovation Oxford. We're here at the Upper Thames sampling site for water quality, and I'm here with Karen, who's actually the big boss when it comes to water quality reports. What does the report tell us?
The watershed report cards, the 2012 watershed report cards, they tell us about the environmental quality of the watersheds that make up the Upper Thames watershed. So the Middle Thames is one of 28 main river sections that we report on and let the public know how we're doing.
And that report card gives what kind of a grade?
The grades range in the Upper Thames from a C to a D, which does not sound good, but we are using a province-wide grading system, and that we're comparing ourselves to pristine areas that have very little population or very little cleared land.
Right, and so what has been contributing to the overall increase in health of this particular river?
This river, the Middle Thames, is one of our top rivers as far as water quality in this watershed, and there has been a lot of activity on this in this area. There's been 18,000 trees planted in the last 5 years, and many clean water projects in the rural areas. There's also a really important part of this river system is the riparian or streamside treed corridor that keeps this river clean.
Well, good news, even though the report card says a C, it's steadily improving.
Yes, yeah. We have 12 watersheds that are improving across the Upper Thames, 16 that have stayed the same since 5 years ago. So we're moving in the right direction.
Why should we care about the quality of water in a stream?
Well, I think the quality of water in a stream really reflects how we're managing issues on the land. Everything we measure in the stream, when we take a sample, we look at E. coli levels.
That frog is interfering.
Yes.
he doesn't like what we're saying.
He's
probably
got something to say.
So, I'm sorry, the quality?
The quality of what we sample in the stream reflects what's happening, how we're managing our waste on the land and in our urban areas. That's all reflected in what we see
so
in the river.
So the quality of this river really is a comment about what's going on in Tillsonburg and Norwich and Tavistock and Woodstock, doesn't it?
Yes, and that's why we look at the smaller watersheds, because people can take ownership over that. This Middle Thames, it runs from Embro, Lakeside, Kintore, down through Tempsford. It's an area that the people living here can identify with. If you're living in Stratford, we report on the Avon River or in Woodstock, Cedar Creek. So it's that scale that people can take some ownership on.
If you want to check out what's happening on this watershed and all the other watersheds under the authority of the Upper Thames Conservation Authority, Google Upper Thames and take a look. We'll be right back after this very short break. We're in the forest about to get a report card on how good this forest is, and I'm here with Kathy Quinlan, who is the terrestrial biologist that's going to fill us in. How are we doing here?
Well, the Middle Thames watershed received a D grade for forest conditions, and there's three indicators of forest conditions for the watershed. One is percent forest cover, and that's just how much forest there is in a watershed or an area. Number two is forest interior, it means how big are the forests? And number three is, where are the forests? Well vegetated are our rivers with forests around them. And when you add all those indicators together, we only get a D. And that's, a D is the average grade for the Upper Thames. We're in southwestern Ontario, we only have around 11 or 12% forest cover left. So that is a lower grade. To get a B, for example, 30% forest cover is what the naturalists are saying we need to sustain our native plants and animals. With such little forest cover left, a lot of the species will in time become extinct. So we need to bulk up our forests, make them larger, connect them, and that's how we can improve our grades.
How do you connect the forests?
Well, you can connect forests by planting between woodlots. For example, if you've got a stream between two woodlots, plant along the stream or along a hedgerow, or if there's vacant land, plant that. If it's connected to another existing woodlot, that's the best place to start planting trees.
Now, this looks like a deciduous forest. It's not exactly old growth, is it?
No, there is no old growth in our watershed. Most all the forests here have been cut several times over since Europeans have lived here. But this forest is in reasonably good shape. This landowner has thinned it out a couple of times, but he's left some fairly good-sized trees, and that's important. There's a good mixture of trees here. We're we're in the Carolinian zone here. We have a lot of southern trees, such as black cherry and walnut, that don't grow further north. So it's great that we can conserve what we can of our own heritage around here.
And this is private land?
This is private land. And virtually all the Upper Thames is on private land. Public ownership is probably less than 5%. So we're not in Northern Ontario where there's Crown land. So we rely on landowners to preserve their forests, to preserve little bits of natural heritage. And there are tax incentives to do that as well. There's tax rebates if you own wetlands and significant natural areas.
Where are we now?
We're at Pete Baldwin's place. He's a landowner within our watershed, and I worked with him back in 2006 and 2007 to retire this piece of land, and he put it into white spruce, white pine, and some European larch.
How big an acreage is it?
It's about 7 or 8 acres that he retired. The whole piece of property is about 200 acres.
It's amazing. Yeah. Why did he do it?
I think he wanted to just enhance his property. He wanted to bulk up the woodlot that's surrounding this whole area. He was using it for agriculture. It wasn't corn, but he just wanted to retire that. It's fairly close to the river over here. He was concerned about erosion problems, so he just put it into trees, and now he's got a beautiful habitat for the wildlife. And
it is amazing.
Recreation.
Brenda, there's a great diversity here. Tell us what some of these trees are.
Well, this one right here is the white pine, and we have the white spruce as well, and then this particular one here is our larch tree.
Looks like a Charlie Brown Christmas tree.
This is a beautiful tree. It does lose their needles in the wintertime.
Brenda, this tree looks very interesting. What's it called?
This is our white pine, and this is our provincial tree. It does have 5 needles in a bunch. The needles come in clusters. See the clusters here?
Yes.
And there's 5 needles in a bunch. And this was considered the peace tree of the First Nation people.
I'm here with Pete Baldwin, who is the owner of this property, and we've of course been down to his replanted pine forest. Tell us, what is your interest in trees?
Very good question, but this was a hilly farm, and it used to be pasture and so on. And when we started thinking about erosion, we thought trees would be a better crop. And I guess I love trees too. And so that's basically, and since then, it's gone from a good farm to a place where trees grow.
Well, we were just down the stream, too, and I'm told that that stream is in excellent condition, and as a result of your work here.
Well, we haven't done much around the stream. I guess keeping cattle out was the first thing, and letting trees grow all around it, keeping it shaded. Evidently, it is a trout.
We didn't find any trout.
No, but I think it's a cold water stream, which means trout could live someday, maybe. But.
Well, we look forward to fishing on your property sometime.
Well, anytime.
But you also didn't grow up farming, did you?
No. Well, I guess I started at 28, and we were in cash crop, and sort of found this place to live on, and have had fun.
Ever since. Well,
yes.
Thanks for taking a few moments. I know it's unexpected, but we wanted to meet the guy that really was behind this this incredible operation.
Well, there were a lot of help too from Upper Thames and MNR and Trees Canada.
We'll be right back with more innovation. Please stay tuned.
Brad, we're going to spend a few minutes talking about the Clean Water Project. Just how much support have you gotten out of the politicians in Oxford County?
Oxford County has been tremendous. They've been probably the best, or the shown more leadership politically than any other municipality in the area with the clean water program. They've supported it financially as well as a partnership with their planning and operations group.
What's the benefit for us taxpayers?
Overall, it's protecting water quality, providing habitat for species at risk, as well as wildlife as a whole, all those good things.
And the groundwater protection, is that also part of your interest?
Yes, groundwater is part of the Clean Water Program. Through the Clean Water Program, as well as the Ontario Drinking Water Stewardship Program, we get involved with decommissioning unused wells, upgrading wellheads, protecting wellhead areas by planting areas to trees and other natural environments to protect that well in those areas.
And you're here to help farmers with their cultural practices. What does that mean?
The biggest part of what we do is with private landowners and with farmers or agricultural producers, doing things like planting trees that you've seen a lot of, erosion control projects, building berms and terraces, grassed waterways across properties, really to protect the soil from rainfall and runoff events and keep it where it should be so that it's used for agricultural production.
You're experiencing global warming. What's that likely to mean for us here in Oxford County in the future? What do we have to be doing?
The biggest thing we see that could possibly happen is more intense storms at different times of the year than we've typically been used to. So we have to be prepared when the soil is most vulnerable, just after crops have been planted, for example, to be able to put the best system in place to protect that soil from eroding and those nutrients in that soil getting into our watercourses, as well as to maintain the productivity of that land, which in this part of Ontario, this part of Canada, some of the best agricultural land that we have.
How long have you been doing this?
I'll be almost 30 years in another year, so I've thoroughly enjoyed it. I've met hundreds and hundreds of farmers and other folks, and it's neat to see all the good things that they're willing and wanting to do.
Yeah, I've never had a farmer that wanted to destroy the land, but do you come and offer advice only when asked?
For the most part, yes. There are times that we strategically approach farmers for various reasons, but in most cases it's all volunteer. They're looking for options and opportunities to improve things.
And those improvements can come at no cost?
We do offer the services for free through the Conservation Authority, the technical services. The financial part, we search and turn over rocks, looking for financial resources all the time. In the case of Oxford County is a keen part of our clean water program. They have committed financially to projects, on-the-ground projects with private landowners for the past 11 years through our clean water program, and they're a great example in that.
Good work, Brad. This may look like what?
The giant hogweed.
But it isn't, is it?
No. And the way you tell is that the seed heads of this particular plant are actually in a globe as opposed to flat, like the Queen Anne's lace.
Huh.
So, you can't misidentify them.
Now Brenda, go down and tear off a little bit. There's a story behind the shoots from this plant.
Right. This plant is a native plant to Canada, to Ontario. And the plant has been used in the past for medicine as well as for food. And the smell of it is quite nice. And it's quite friendly. It doesn't cause a rash or anything like that. So,
what'd your mother do with this?
My mother, she doesn't do anything with this.
What's your grandmother?
My grandmother used to put the shoots in the Christmas cake.
Now this is considered an aphrodisiac, right?
It has been, yes, in the past, known to be an aphrodisiac. But you used to be able to buy this at the local store, the general store, and they would candy the shoot and actually use it in cakes and that type of thing. So.
Amazing. What is the name of this particular plant?
It's Purple Angelica.
I'm here with Jay, and the machine behind us is doing a very quick job of thinning this forest. Jay, describe for us the process that's being employed. What's happening in that machine?
Well, years ago when plantations are planted, they're planted too close together, and they need to be thinned out on a regular basis. So behind us is Justin Oliveria from Ontario Thinning Specialists. And what happens first is a tree marker comes in. He marks the trees that need to be removed. And then Justin comes in with his harvester, and he'll come along and he'll cut down the trees that are marked. As as he's cutting the trees, there's the computerized head measures the diameter and the length of each log and each tree, and it lets Justin know when he needs to make a cut. He cuts it, and at the end of the day, it gives him a volume or percentage of wood cut. And obviously the idea is to open this up. This opens things up, lets the trees that remain, it releases them is what we call it, so that they get a little bit bigger and they have more room to grow as time goes on. And then eventually the idea is that we would see some hardwoods start to come in here. Things like sugar maple and black cherry, native trees in the area that we'd like to see.
How old are these trees?
These trees are probably anywhere between 25 to 30 years old, which is the exact time that we want to come in here. If they get older than that, they start to get too tall and too skinny, and they become they could be subject to wind throw, which is where high winds come in and they blow too much of it down, and it's a very bad thing. And then we start seeing invasive species come in, like buckthorn and raspberry and dog strangling vine. But this way, it's a controlled thinning, and it's much better for the ecosystem of the forest.
Why has it taken so long for you to come in here and thin?
The reason we wouldn't want to get in there too early, there's two sides of it. One is the economic sense. Justin needs to be able to come in, and he needs to be able to, it has to be worth his while, so he needs to be able to make some money on it. The other reason is if you come in too early is the trees are too short, and they don't release, as I said, they don't release the way we want them to. They'll just sort of be stagnant.
Why were they planted so close together to begin with?
Well, that's something back from the M&R days when things were planted that close. It's not too far off from what we do now. Now, though, we go more with a diversity of species when we do the plantings, whereas 30 years ago, they went more with the monoculture. So again,
monoculture is the same tree.
The same tree over and over again. So this is why we definitely have to come in and do the thinning. Ideally, Brenda talked to you earlier about the planting down in the flat area. We probably won't have to do the same type of thinning down there that we have to do up here.
Because they're planted further apart.
Yeah.
We saw that.
And with the diversity as well.
Where are these logs going to end up?
These logs will end up at a local sawmill. And they're all saw logs. Unfortunately, there isn't much of a pulp and paper market anymore. The only pulp and paper plant in the area is St. Mary's Pulp and Paper up in Sault Ste. Marie. Unfortunately, with shipping costs and the high price of fuel these days, it's not worth it to ship all the pulp and paper up that far. Unfortunately, there's no money in it for the landowner. There's no money in it for the operator of the thinning.
So you're doing this to improve the forest.
Yes.
Project 20 years from now. What's likely to be growing from this forest floor?
Like I said, ideally we'll probably see some natural white pine regeneration. Then we'll also see species like sugar maple, black cherry, and there's already ash starting to come in here.
Amazing. Look like a destructive process, but it really isn't. The sun is shining, the forest floor is now open to the sky, the canopy has been opened up, and in a few years this whole area will begin to regenerate, and hopefully, probably, there'll be hardwood forests growing here in a number of years. I'm Mike Harding for Innovation Oxford. We'll see you next time.